We're standing here on Liberty Mountain. We're standing on the ground that for 3 years we have prayed that will one day be the site of the greatest Christian school in the world. We prayed that way. We believe God gave us this mountain for that purpose.
Money. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
That's it, please.
Yeah, some of the early years with Chris, you know, when I think back, there's a lot of sentimentalism that goes with it, because when your kids grow up, there's a lot of history there. Chris's hockey career really started with his brother Caleb back in Saskatoon, I think. We were just before moving to Edmonton when he actually started playing. We'd do a lot of sort of crawling around the rec room on our knees with little mini sticks, and you know, I'd just get all excited with them, and you know, I could see his competitive nature back then. So moving to Edmonton and starting ice hockey was pretty much a natural sort of progression.
I first came into hockey just because it was kind of a way of life growing up in Canada, and we just watched hockey all the time. It was our favorite pastime, all the games. I remember during 2006 lockout season, my brother and I watched the NHL channel and watched all the old school games because there's no new games going on. So we really enjoyed the game. Moved to Edmonton when I was 6 or 7. We started shooting pucks in the garage, playing ball hockey out front, just on the street. And my dad said, I think it's time we put the boys in. So we consulted with a family friend from church, Keith Kreider, his name is. And he said, Don, you really need to. Those boys love it.
Well, I remember when we had opportunities to go to things with athletes in action. We tried to take advantage of every opportunity for the hockey schools that they had in Saskatchewan at the time. So we did a few road trips that way in order for him to be with other Christian athletes and to have that example in his life.
I got saved when I was 7 at a Christian hockey camp in Briarcrest University out in Saskatchewan. It was a pretty cool experience. I remember the night there was 2 Saskatchewan Rough Riders, which is a Canadian Football League team. It was my favorite team being born in Saskatchewan. They were there, they kind of said their testimonies, and it was a pretty special event. It was run by Briarcrest University, so it was run by Hockey Ministry International. So there's a whole bunch of Christians. We were around 7 or 8 years old at that time. And we got to play hockey, hear the testimonies of them, and then make that decision later on that night. And it was obviously the best decision I could have ever made in my life. I'm not sure when I was 7 I understood it the same as I understand it now, the extent of how it's played out in my favor throughout my life, kind of shaping who I was as a person, knowing I have God on my side, falling back on that, really relying on Him changed me. I went through quite a few trials, through whether it was on ice or off the ice. And just having that confidence that there is a greater plan. I'm not in this alone. There is light at the end of the tunnel. It was definitely a game changer. It got me through a lot of sleepless nights and got me through a lot of hardships that I faced, whether it be on or off the ice.
You know, Chris being around some of these athletes who either had come from a faith background or, you know, found faith in Jesus while they were moving through, their own athletic careers. It was really great for, him and his brother to be able to see those people, to see what, being a follower of Jesus in a competitive athletic industry could look like. And so I think Chris particularly, took a real liking to a lot of these kind of guys. And, we could see little examples of him modeling some of their behavior. And even when he got into junior hockey and he started doing interviews and little sort of, scrum things after the game, you could see how, Christ began to sort of emerge in terms of how he spoke.
It's opening night in Lynchburg. Hey there, friends. Welcome to the Hill City, where the Liberty Flames are set to take on the NC State Ice Pack. And Brandon, this is a Liberty team, despite it being day one of the regular season, really believes they have the opportunity to win a national championship this year.
And with the schedule that they have, I believe that they're going to be set up for success this year.
Yeah, 100%. It's a veteran-laden squad in LU, and we expect big things for them.
I think one of the most pivotal moments in Chris's faith life, again, has been an incredibly difficult part of his young life. When he was 14, he lost his best friend, Sean, to leukemia. It was a long journey. It was a year of ups and downs, and the tail end of that was incredibly painful. And I remember standing in the hospital room the day before Sean died. And Sean was hooked up to every tube and machine you could possibly think that could be in a room like that. And just watching Chris, process death, at such an early age, I would not have wished that on my son. I don't even wish it on my son now. As an adult, I don't wish it on anybody.
You don't really understand why things like that happen, especially when you're, 11 to 15. It's a pretty big stage in your life. You're kind of figuring out who you are as a person. You're kind of growing up, maturing, going into high school. It was definitely hard. There was definitely a lot of questions I had, and I think a lot of it I tried to brush under the rug as much as I could, and that didn't end up playing in my favor. I ended up seeking help. I did go to a counselor to help me through it. It was a Christian counselor, which I'd recommend to anybody through hardships. He really helped me through it, just kind of setting aside the anger, the sadness I felt. I put a lot of it into masking the sadness with hockey or with friends at school or with grades or just distracting myself. But looking back on it now, I'm really proud of myself and really proud of Sean of how we handled it. And even today I was in the gym, when I'm finishing my last few reps on overhead press, I was thinking about him, if he could do it, I can do it. And I'm sure you'll notice if you look through some footage, I pointed to the sky quite a bit after any goal I was on the ice for, and it was always to Sean. And not a lot of people knew that, but they would kind of say you score and you point to God. And I said, yeah, kind of, but at the same time, I'm pointing to Sean because he is my motivation through a lot of it all.
Although that was one of the most painful and probably will go down as one of the most painful experiences of his young life, his desire to sort of prove himself, to do it for Sean, was, I think, what he said at the time, is probably what drove Chris to near exhaustion as a hockey player. Just his insatiable desire to somehow prove that he had what it took.
Hey, new game today! New game, same formula! same formula, right? We take it right to it, right from the get-go. Physical play starts on the first shift, and we go for 60 minutes. We don't back down, and we improve today on where our journey wants to take us at the end of the year, right?
Gammer, shorthanded breakaway, scores! Hawks top the circle with room, scores! Hand off from Onbright, near the point, just opened up a lane for Cox. Gets it off, Kalendijk, another shot, rebound, scores! Onbright, his first of the year. Hunter Verostek casts the shutout as the Flames return home. Gets it to him, Feenstra scores!
My favorite goal I've ever scored was against the Brooks Bandits in the Alberta Junior Hockey League. Spruce Grove and Brooks, prior to me playing on Spruce Grove, had a huge rivalry. They kind of went back and forth with being the top team in the league. So my rookie year, it was 1-1 with a minute left, and the coach put my line out there, and we weren't the first line by any means, but he trusted us. We went out there. It was me and Matthew Rempe, who currently plays for the New York Rangers in the NHL. We went down on a 2-on-1.
1 minute left to go in the third period. Matt Rempe.
And he passed it to me in the middle, and I dove and chipped the puck over the goalie's shoulder with like 50 seconds left in the game.
Over the blue line, up ahead for Bladen, the shot, the goal! Chris Bladen puts it over the glove of Pierce Charleston, and the Spruce Grove Saints, with 55.5 seconds left to go, have taken a 4-3 lead.
To hand Brooks their first loss of the season at home ice on Spruce Grove's rink with all the fans there, and that was the best goal I've ever scored in my life and the most memorable. And I think now that Rempe's made the NHL, whether he remembers me or not, that this makes it even better.
And Bladen finally breaks the streak of not being able to score with a beautiful one. Just picks up that pass, perfectly placed by Rempe, and sneaks it past Charleston. Just a perfect backdoor play for that one.
Going through junior was definitely a roller coaster for me. As soon as I finished my midget AAA team, I went right with the Spruce Grove Saints for their playoff run. And I was just, they call us black aces. Like, we didn't play, we just practiced. In the event of an injury, I was an affiliate player, so I'd be called up. So I was with them every day, on the ice every day, traveling with them for games. And I actually got to watch them win a championship. I was in the building. So that was a really cool experience. It was a great start to junior. We went to the Doyle Cup, which is the winner of the Alberta Junior Hockey League versus the winner of the British Columbia Hockey League. And we fell to Wenatchee Wild, but it was cool. I got to play a couple games in that. I was fortunate enough to get my feet wet in junior with that. So coming into my rookie year in junior with the Spruce Grove Saints, it was a lot of fun. I felt pretty confident. 30 games in, I got traded. I think my first 8 games, I was scratched 5 of them. Like, it was a super bummer. I thought I had a good summer, but it just the way it went for me. So 30 games in, I got traded from a really good team in Canada, pretty recognized, to a team in Calgary, Alberta, for the Mustangs.
As things typically go in competitive sport, you know, you can be loved on Friday and traded on Monday. It seems that sort of became his reality, and so he moved south a little closer to where we were living at the time, but to a team that, quite frankly, was struggling in every possible way you could struggle.
I was super kind of like hurt by the trade. I was kind of rattled by it. I think anybody would be at that point. And with my luck, the Calgary Mustangs ran out of money and folded. So then I kind of scrambled, went to a different team in Lloydminster. It wasn't the best fit.
Chris essentially just packed it in one day after a series of conversations and situations that he was really incredibly uncomfortable with. He more or less just had an extra interview with the coach and drove away.
So I went home and I told my dad, like, that's it, I'm quitting. I've been on 3 different junior teams in a year and a quarter. I thought, this is ridiculous. It's not fun anymore. I'm gonna go to Grant McEwen in Edmonton and just start pursuing an education.
I think it had to be his choice. And so him and his dad had many heated conversations at that time.
Well, heated, I think passionate.
Passionate conversations, word, let's say passionate conversations. And then that's when the mom comes in with the voice of reason. And I just said, you know what, whether you play hockey or not, You are set up for success. You're a wonderful person. God has great big plans for you, and it's going to be all right. No matter what happens, it's going to be all right.
And then that's when WayWay Sea Capital, they reached out to me pretty much 5 minutes after I left my meeting with my previous team, and they said, we'd love for you to come play for us. We'll send you your contract. It's like not really a contract, it's amateur, but there's a letter of intent, like a player card. And I said, okay, thank you very much. Like, I'll think about it. Like, I really like you as a team and as people, but I don't know like where I'm at.
When it comes right down to it, you know, it's a choice. It, you know, just like everything in life, it's a choice. So, you know, you can hang up skates, you can go home, you can go find yourself a job or go to school somewhere, or you can walk through what appears to me an open door. I don't know what's on the other side, I have no idea. It's another junior hockey team, it's another community, it's another barn with, you know, a bunch of screaming fans, you know, I don't know. I'm sure what you're gonna get when you get there.
And then my dad said, Chris, you have to go to WayWay. And I said, I'm only going if Mom drives me there.
We took the 12-hour journey together. We actually had a great time in the car. Lots of fun, lots of time to connect. And then we got there and...
Lots of tears for his mother.
Yeah, no, that was when I left him there. No, when we drove there, we had a lot of fun together. And then we saw the rink. It was a beautiful facility, wonderful people, very welcoming, warm. We went to his billet's house, his Christian family, lived on a bit of an acreage with animals, so it was kind of nice. And I said, so do you want to stay? And he said, well, I'll stay for the week.
My initial plan was to go for a day and then turn around and come back just to tell my dad, like, okay, now you can stop talking to me. I went and I tried it and I didn't like it. And so I went for a day, and then my mom was like, to stay for a week. And me and my mom have a super special connection. Like, she kind of understands the emotional side of me. I wear my heart on my sleeve. And I was like, okay, 1 week, and in a week you guys drive back and pick me up. And they said, my mom was like, all right, that's fine. And the first week, I think I scored like 4 or 5 goals, and I thought, okay, I definitely will stay here. I'm having a lot of fun with these coaches, with the players and the team. It was a great environment all around.
I dropped him off, and then I think I cried halfway to Lethbridge, hoping that we made the right decision. But look, we did. We did. God sustained, and he kept, and it was actually a great experience for him.
The memories we made there, there was nothing to do in that town except hang out with my friends. I met some really good friends, went over there with Garrick Ripley, who was one of my good friends back from Edmonton growing up in Alberta. And actually, funny enough, the coaches, Taylor Harnett and Josh Lee, Taylor Harnett coached my club in Edmonton growing up the whole way, so we were pretty familiar with him. And Josh Lee was the assistant coach on that team, and he was the man who taught me how to skate with Better Player Hockey. So it's kind of full circle with that. I really enjoyed that. I had a lot of fun in WayWay. I scored a lot of goals, made a lot of friends, and it kind of felt like it was all coming together for me at that point.
He only spent a half a season with that team, and COVID hit, of course, and you know, all of the other crazy things that go with that whole COVID period went on. Yeah, he wasn't sure what he's going to do, and the whole conversation around Liberty came up, and you know, basically, hey, you know, why don't you, you know, come down, give it a shot.
We got to be ready to go. I've been going all day thinking about this one. Fellas, we need to come to play tonight. Hey, we talked about this earlier. Simple, smarter, relentless. Let's get in. Let's lay the body. Let's keep the tide going our way all night. And when it's not, and someone comes off, head up, and away we get going again with a dose of encouragement for the rest of the guys. We stick together for all 60 minutes. Let's get the puck in deep. Take it tonight. I don't care what they do. Take everything tonight. We're ready to go. And you got to play. Let's go.
Get the highlight reel from Brent Gammon, because that was a beauty.
strike with speed. It's to make some noise. Shot. Rebound!
And Liberty will take game one and two. The weekend series against the rival Bobcats.
I never heard of Liberty other than Cole Gammer and Brett Gammer playing for them. I thought Liberty was on the west coast of America up until when I started talking to Kirk. I'd never really heard of it. I didn't know what league it was in. I didn't know it was even Christian at that point. And I was at a poker night with Bea Richards. She went to high school with me. Her whole family did, the Richard family. They're great people that we still stay in contact with. And I said, so your brother's going to Liberty next year, Dustin? And she was like, yeah. And I said, tell me about Liberty. Like, I've heard the Gammers go there. I heard they have a hockey team. And she said, yeah, it's like a great place. I love it. I'd recommend anyone to go there. And I said, well, tell Cole that I'm interested. And the next day, Cole Gammer called me, and he was super encouraging, told me about it. And then the next day, I texted Brett Gammer, and I said, hey, like, I heard you're at Liberty. What do you think of it? I'm thinking about maybe reaching out to Kirk. And he was super enthusiastic about it, super encouraging with it. And at that point, I felt like a lot of love from a teammate, where a lot of times in junior, you don't feel that kind of love. It's kind of like, stay away from my team. Like, this is my territory, this is my land. But he was like, open arms, come here. And that's when I think I first fell in love with it, because I thought, holy smokes, this is a teammate who like wants me to come here, like open arms, super encouraging, super nice. I could feel the love. At that point, I knew it was Christian. And then the doors just opened. I think the next day I called Kirk, and Kirk got me accepted because it was 2 months before the season. Within 2 weeks of that, I like committed. It was crazy. And I think what led me to Liberty was God. I think every single door got opened at the perfect moment. And there was just no telling me that God wasn't at play. God didn't bring me to Wayway for this purpose. God didn't have the things happen throughout junior and happen throughout my life to make me not go somewhere like Liberty.
Well, Chris is a talented hockey player, and that was the first thing when the video came in. We noticed he was a talented hockey player, but the most attractive thing about Chris is obviously who he is and the person that he wants to grow to become. And for us, that's a key component. What we look for is people who want to be champions for Christ. Obviously, we say champions for Christ in the world of hockey. And so Chris is someone who wants to be a world changer. He wants to come in here and make a difference. And it's been interesting with that mindset. He's come in here and he's grown personally, and also he's grown the rest of our group of guys with him.
Yeah, Kirk will do anything for you. Like, he's just such a great guy who has the ability to impact a lot of people's lives, and he knows that, and he doesn't waste a second of doing it. So over the recruitment process with Kirk, there's obviously, they don't want to bring this to anybody, they want to make sure it's a good fit. He asked for two letters of reference, or two references for me. So it's my high school teacher and one of my old coaches, and he called them, and after he talked to them, he called me back and said, we're confident moving me forward, do you want to fly down and see the place before you commit? And I said, well, this is during COVID. Like, if I go down to you, I have to come back and quarantine for 2 weeks. At that point, we're a month out from me coming. Like, there's just no point. I feel confident, so I'm gonna come. So he definitely called me a lot. Ben Hughes also did a lot of work for that. And they're just both great human beings. And when I came here, they did the exact same thing the whole time. Just, they do anything for you whenever you need it. They're here to help, and they're here to serve. And I'm really grateful for both of them.
Here's Bladen. Quick shot, scores! What a goal! Bladen showing off some soft hands as he just tucks that one in under the bar. Got some open ice, and man, sending it towards the goal, they score! Chris Bladen!
He has been easily one of the hardest working Flames that we've seen all season long, and it finally pays off.
Liberty, they've got numbers, a 2-on-1, shot, scores! Short!
Good to see him get a look on this PK, and that's what he does so well. Off the change, comes out quickly.
Influence the direction of that pass, and now Bladen, he has some room as the Bobcats will quickly collapse on him, but they will go punish, as that will be a penalty by way of the Bobcats, and Bladen slow to get up.
I was in the offensive zone against Ohio, and I kind of went down to take a shot. Like, I kind of dropped to a knee because I was in like a tight space, and a guy came across and like hit me directly here to the head. And it's probably like a hit that doesn't look like as bad as some other hits that have happened, but I guess just the way he hit me, it affected me pretty good, obviously, and it got me good.
I think hockey became a lesser god. I think it helped him grow in his faith, as much of a struggle as what it was to be out for 9 months. But with a concussion, it's not necessarily something you can see. And so I think it helped Chris put a lot of what hockey has done for him and what it's really meant to be into perspective. And I think the journey inevitably allowed him to see that his young life and where he was going was becoming less about hockey and more about his character.
My concussion was super hard for me. Obviously the first few months of it, I experienced a lot of symptoms. And then after that, it just prolonged like minor symptoms. Like I couldn't step on the ice without a headache or feeling like I was in like the third person. And it definitely forced me to step away from hockey. And you know, at some points you're like, I don't know if I will return. This is my senior year. Like if it goes on too long, like this just could be it. And you end on a concussion, which would have been one of the saddest things ever after working your whole life towards goals you have in hockey.
Yeah, so interesting, when Chris went out, Chris obviously wasn't able to play, wasn't able to practice. Chris's role became more valuable to the team as he grew in the relationships with other guys. He went through the book, A Search for Significance, with our team chaplain, and our team chaplain said, hey, I'm going to go through this book with you, but then I want you now to invest in other players on your team. So then Chris's mindset became not self-focused, but other-focused, and when he did, we really saw some tremendous growth in him and our team.
He pushed me a lot in letting go of Chris as a hockey player to Chris as a human being, and finding my worth not in how I play on the ice, finding my worth through Jesus, because when Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just die for one portion of our life, he died for every portion, so we can identify ourselves as a follower of Christ first. And that took a ton of pressure off me, and it was definitely one thing that grew my faith tremendously over even the past 3 years. And now I'm able to pour into others on the team and others just in the community, and as I go forward, pour that same message into others to relieve some of the pressure and anxiety that comes with performance and high competition to putting it all into Jesus.
I think about the verse, Matthew 7:12, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. And I think in that particular situation, you want him to invest in others. You want him to work with others. And even though he can't be on the ice battling with them, maybe his battle can be with guys in the other areas of their life. And so when Chris talked to Brian and met with him, Brian's encouragement to him was, hey, I'm going to invest in you, but now then you invest in other people.
You know, isn't that what adversity does, right, to our faith? I mean, if we could all live on the mountain forever, it'd be wonderful, right? I'm not sure it would do much for our faith, you know, but sometimes these valley experiences, sometimes these challenges and adversity can result in wonderful things, but you know, we just don't naturally choose those things, they choose us.
So there's definitely a ton of help that it would have been impossible without without them caring for me as a person, not just as a player. Because, you know, there's lots of teams out there that would just replace you at that point, but here they care about you as a person and want you to get better because they genuinely care about Chris, they don't just care about Bladen. So that was super nice to have that. And as hard as the situation was, I was able to get past it and play the second half of the year.
Well, I think a lot of people would have given up. A lot of people would have given up when they faced the adversity Chris did with his concussions and all that stuff, and he battled through it, and that allowed him the opportunity to play at the end of the year, which is a great way to cap off his career.
When we opened the rink in 2006, Dr. Fowler said, hey, you sure we're going to get people here? I said, yeah, man. So he said, well, we aren't going to put any stands in. So about the fourth game, and Ron Gavin pulled me aside and said, hey, call me Monday. We're putting bleachers in.
Hope. What's my definition of success?
Bury it. Callendike off the circle. Kicks it towards goal. Quick shot stop by Verostin.
Standing up for what you know is. Right where everybody else is.
Tucking them to shot, second chance. Parisi saves them both.
Another quick shot stop by Verostin. That's around one. And another. Fultz scores.
Christ as your Lord and Savior.
baptized in Finland was definitely unreal. Who can say they've been baptized there? I grew up in the Salvation Army, so both my parents are pastors in the Salvation Army. And we don't do a baptism. We do like soldiership pledges and stuff like that. Pretty similar thing, like a public declaration of your faith. But we were never against it. It just wasn't what we did at all. And obviously being baptized doesn't make you saved, doesn't make you go to heaven. It's just a public declaration of your faith. So doing that in Finland was definitely amazing with David Pike, the pastor at the Hämeenlinna Fellowship.
We watched online and have never been more proud of Chris and the commitment that he's made not only to God but to the greater community. But I think what really struck me as a mom was the fact that he was able to share his faith with his roommate and his teammate, and his teammate came to know Jesus and was baptized as well. And to see our son start and be able to lead someone to Jesus in that journey at that time, I think, wow, God is unbelievable. He's amazing how he works all these things out for good to those who love him and draws people to himself. It's just absolutely amazing. So we're very proud.
Just seeing his level of maturity. I was nowhere near that when I was his age, to be truthful. Just his ability to sort of focus in, to prioritize. He's got an incredible capacity for friendship, for relationship. He's incredibly compassionate.
Chris really got the ball rolling. One night we talked about, he came and talked to me about baptism, and we kind of said, hey, like, let's throw it out to the other guy, see if anyone else wants to do it. And at the end of the night, we had one guy get saved, four guys get baptized, and then the next night we had another guy get baptized. And so Chris became the catalyst by being bold in his faith and by saying, hey, it's a decision I want to make in my own life, had a positive multiplying effect on four other guys.
To be able to witness to some of the younger guys as a Christian, where I found my purpose in Jesus rather than hockey, was definitely super special for me. I was finally able to practice what others are preaching to me. Finland was a huge highlight. You know, Finch got saved in Finland. That's the biggest victory we could have over the year. There's a lot more to life and a lot more to what we do than hockey. As badly as each one of us do want to win, what is winning? And that was a question that Brian Davidson challenged me with for 2 years, 2 years plus. He said, what is winning, Chris? Is winning on the scoreboard, or is winning seeing people saved? Is it glorifying Christ? And that was one thing that I think I'll never forget over this year, is learning that, like, what truly is winning? What is victory? I want to come on the ice and compete, but I can only compete to the best I can to glorify God. And win or lose, it is what it is. There's a lot more at play in our lives than winning, and there's a lot more value we can have and hold our heads high after, regardless of the result.
Hockey night in the Hill City returns. Hey there, friends. Welcome to the campus of Liberty University, where tonight the Liberty Flames face off against the Syracuse Orange. Well, the race to the Murdoch Cup begins as the Liberty Flames and Syracuse Orange meet here, first game of second semester for Liberty as they step onto the ice looking to remain in the top 10 of the nation. Another try. Rebound.
Nice goal from the Green Flames to get their first of 2024.
Leading point scorer, Jacob Kaldyk for LU. Cuts in, fires, and scores!
Leading point scorer for the Flames, yeah, I'm that guy.
So the last 2 weeks before Nationals, we just really got down to business and worked as hard as we could, really. That's all there really is to it. We knew what the stakes were. A lot of us, it was going to be our last nationals ever, and everyone loves playoff hockey. You know, everyone wants to be at their best.
Quick up, quick up. Yep. Oh. Oh. What a drive back. I'll go side.
Yes.
Good job, Billy. Nothing.
Got your feet down there, eh?
PPK won. Taking care of business, you know. One.
Listen, you were gone for a while. I took over. I'm the boss now. Look at me. I'm the captain.
No, I never look at you. No.
Look at me.
Well, if you're joining us from a galaxy far, far away, welcome to the LaHaye Ice Center in Lynchburg, Virginia for Star Wars Night, a top five matchup in the ACHA, the number two team in the nation. The Adrian Bulldogs come to town on a 17-game win streak, looking to end the Flames' winning ways.
Hey, fellas, hey, we need a big start. Let's focus on the first 10 minutes. What are we going to do in the first 10 minutes? We want to man's up puck well. We want to get pucks in deep. We want to establish ourselves right from the get-go. Get the crowd going. Get us going. Hey, that loud, active, positive bench pays dividends not only tonight, but as we move forward.
Of that, 3-0 is the score for the Liberty Flames.
First of all, I'd like to thank the parents in here for your sacrifice, trust, and partnership. We realize we're just talking to Vicky about a few minutes ago. We're going to have to replace 8 players next year. That's a tough job, but all of you guys along the journey with us have different stories. Think of Chris, who was in the middle of COVID. He hadn't been down here from Canada. He trusted us without even coming to visit Liberty that this was a great place. This group of guys became legacy builders. And we saw it about halfway through the year. They started to pass the torch on to the younger guys, and they saw their role here as being bigger than an on-ice role, but being an off-ice role. And when we're in Finland to see 5 guys get baptized, 2 guys get saved, 1 guy got saved over there, another guy got saved when we got back here. It just shows the tenacity of this group that they were here for a greater mission. We talk about training champions for Christ. Training champions for Christ is coming here and becoming a champion, leaving as a champion, but then passing the torch to the next generation. And so for us, as coaches, that's awesome to see, right? That's why we're here. That's what Liberty's all about.
We're going to train up a generation of young people who will shake this old world for our Lord. Do you believe God answers prayer?
We welcome you to Lynchburg, Virginia, the campus of Liberty University. Night is falling, and we're excited for a top 10 matchup in the ACHA. Niagara Purple Eagles coming to Central Virginia to take on the Liberty Flames. It's open on that far point. Now he goes back door. They look for a quick shot. Scores! Feenster with some help. It looks like Schenke got a piece of it. And it's 1-0 LU.
Jurassic put on a clinic there. It's the team's best penalty killer.
To the net.
Kalendijk
firing, scores!
One thing I've always told Chris throughout his whole hockey playing days is that hockey is what he likes to do. It's what he enjoys to do. It's not who he is. And I think that's a message for all of us, is that we enjoy doing many things, and we all find our career path and the thing that we're passionate about, but that's not who we are, right? We're more than that. And that's a message that I've tried to teach Chris throughout the years, is that you are not hockey. Hockey is what you enjoy doing. You are more than that. And God has wonderful things in store for Chris, and I can hardly wait to see and experience and journey with him as he explores all that God has for him. But whatever he does, that's not who he is, right? It's what he enjoys. He's way more than that.
I think the biggest lesson I learned was life doesn't always go your way. I like to have control in what happens to me. And that's one thing my mom's been preaching to me is, Chris, stop trying to play God. There's a God that's gonna do that for you. So there's a lot of things that happen that you just have no control over, and you just have to accept the fact that you just gotta do your best. And that's probably the most valuable, the resiliency that built up. Hearing the words no, feeling what a loss feels like, making a lot of friends, making connections. I think it did help me mature a lot as a man, because you're put into a grown-up's world at a pretty young age, where you have to interact with a lot of coaches, a lot of scouts, a lot of other parents, and you really have to present yourself in a way that they're gonna want you. So it helps you really mature into who you are as a person, and be confident in public and be confident around. So that's one thing that will play a benefit to me in the future, is my ability to interact with a lot of people, whether it's the business world, whether it's at church, whether it's at the rink one day with my future kids. Definitely a lot of good lessons were taught.
And, you know, albeit lots of guys, you know, they succeed in many, many ways, because there's lots of great athletes out there. From where Chris has come from to where he's ended up, regardless of what anybody thinks about him as a player or otherwise, to me, he's incredible. He's remarkable. And it's so much more than just skill. For me, it's about who he is. It's about his depth of character. It's about his maturity. And it's about his ability to be resilient. Because I don't know of too many guys, maybe even most of the guys on the team that he's playing on now, I would doubt many of them have gone through, you know, as much as what I've seen him personally go through. And maybe that's a bit of a reach, maybe I'm overstating, I don't know, but it's just really meant to say that what I've seen Chris work through and overcome in his young life, nothing short of remarkable. And so to say that I'm proud of him, that's more than just words. I wish I could communicate that in a way that he would fully, maybe that I would even fully appreciate what I'm saying, because I think I know.
I'm fired up. It's the last ride. Last four games for me my whole career before I start the beer league grind. So kind of emotional, but it'll be a good time. I'm ready to go. I think the lead-up's been good with Chris Kerr. We seem to get a lot of good stuff going for us. Lines are buzzing. We've been getting the systems down pat, working on the D-zone a lot. It's an exciting time. Going up today will be good. It's Wednesday. We play on Saturday, so the bus legs will be long gone. It'll be all right. We'll be ready.
Lord's obviously blessed this place. He's obviously blessed the vision of the Falwell family back in those very early years of what could be here. Yeah, it's going to be very interesting to see what the next few years hold, not only for Chris, but you know, for the entire Liberty family. What's God going to do here? What's going to happen with those who pass through these doors and you know, in a few years exit? and go elsewhere. You know, what's the Lord going to do with all of that? It remains to be seen, I guess, right? So it's the beauty of our faith.
Well, this has been our day on the mountain. We've entitled this program, I Want That Mountain. Bill Harvey's song, we sing it all the time. We sing it by faith. We sing it in prayer. We sing it as praise. We sing it as worship. We sing it when we are in our bedrooms. We sing it driving in the automobile. And we're talking about Liberty Mountain, that beautiful 3,500-acre miracle that God has said, I've given to you to train young men and young women to shake this world for God.
Know that in my weakness I am strong, but it's your love that brings me home.